and afternoon to all of you. I've been asked to share my views on the present state of justice and human rights in the Philippines. I will try to do justice to that request as candidly and in as straightforward a manner as I can. I think I will be the first, but not the only person, to say that the Philippines is a land of contradictions. We have a beautiful country, but I must admit, terribly ugly cities. We're very rich in natural resources, but our people are mired in poverty. We're kind and honest as a people, but again, I must admit, present company excluded, we have quite a corrupt bureaucracy. We've endured a lot of suffering, but we have retained a very keen sense of humor. And on a more superficial level, there's a lot of nice places to go, to eat, shop, and live, but our traffic is really bad. Our legal system is no exception to that. We have one of the highest populations of lawyers and law schools in the region. You might be surprised to know that we have over 130 law schools in this small country of ours. We have one of the hardest bar examinations, I'm told, in the entire world, but we lack accountability. I'm not sure if you know that our conviction rates only hover in the area of 30%, which means that only 3 out of 10 persons prosecuted by our Department of Justice actually get convicted. We have no system for ensuring that those who are convicted actually serve their sentences. There was a study made by a foreign funding agency about 8 years ago, where they looked at 110 cases of persons convicted by final judgment of graft and corruption offenses. You might be surprised to know that they only found 10 of those 110 in jail. The other 100 people were nowhere to be found. Our courts are clogged. We have an average calendar of 20 to 30 cases a day for our trial courts, and our cases take forever. I think you're lucky if your case gets litigated in 6 to 10 years. My own record is a human rights case that lasted all of 29 years before it was resolved. We have a perennial problem with vacancies both in our trial courts and in the prosecution service. 20% of our trial courts are vacant. 34% of our public prosecution positions are also vacant. Our judiciary gets a very thin slice of our national budget, somewhere in the area of only about 2%, and our justice system has very little credibility in the eyes of lawyers and the public at large. There was a survey made of lawyers about 10 years ago. They were asked, in your perception, how widespread is corruption, A, in the trial courts, B, in the Court of Appeals, and C, in the Supreme Court? More than half, 56% of the lawyers said they believe corruption was widespread in the trial courts. 39% believe corruption is widespread in the Court of Appeals, and 20% believe it is widespread in the Supreme Court. And if that is how lawyers look at our legal system, you can imagine how our people view it. To understand why the legal system of our country is in such a deplorable state, I think we have to go back in time. We have to look at some particular slices of history that will maybe give us a better idea of why we are in such a state today. As a colony of Spain and the United States, our country, our legal system, is really a hybrid of both colonial powers. Our substantive laws, civil laws, property, family laws, and the like, are of Spanish origin. But our court procedure and evidence, those laws, are of American origin. But the problem is that although we adopted the rules of court procedure and evidence from the United States, we never adopted a jury system. And the sad reality of it is that for the last 120 years, we have been using court rules of procedure and evidence that were designed for a jury system when all our court cases are decided by judges who are lawyers. In fact, there was a study made by some American Bar Association experts on evidence who commented, and I quote, "The Philippines does not have a jury system. Thus, experts would query as to why the Philippine rules of evidence replicate all the complexities of this and other evidence rules." I wish I could end there, but I must say that that is not all that is the problem with our justice system. Because our justice system was emasculated by a dictatorship that lasted 14 years, that stripped our judiciary of its independence, and weakened its moral fiber. And a succession of administrations that failed to strengthen its weakened pillars and foundations. I'm sad to say that it is again under siege today by a government that appears bent on supplanting justice from the courts with justice from the barrels of guns. Let's go back some 45 years to September 29, 1972, 1 week after the declaration of martial law. Then President Marcos issued this letter of instruction number 11, where he directed, I quote, "I hereby direct all officers of the national government whose appointments are vested in me as president to submit their resignations from office not later than October 15, 1972. That included judges. Not satisfied with that, the following year, in 1973, the regime changed the constitution and put into action two provisions that are seldom discussed even among lawyers, sections 9 and 10 of the transitory provisions. All officials and employees in the existing government shall continue in office until otherwise provided by law or decreed by the incumbent president, and I'm sure you know who that was. And it says the incumbent members of the judiciary continue in office until they reach the age of 70 years, unless sooner replaced in accordance with the preceding section hereof. What was the impact of Letter of Instruction 11 and the 1973 Constitution on our justice system? Well, my answer can be summarized in two words: judicial capture. From 1972 until 1986, the Marcos regime owned every single judge in the country. For 14 years, he could remove any judge anytime, for any cause, or even without cause, and he did. I quote from the State of the Nation after 3 years of martial law issued by the Civil Liberties Union of the Philippines in 1975. "All judges from the highest to the lowest work under the threat of dismissal at any time. Mr. Marcos can replace any judge anytime he is disposed to do so, and in fact has repeatedly done so. Veteran judges of long service have been dismissed through court notices of acceptance of their compulsory resignations." Can we now view the judiciary as independent, able to protect the litigants and those accused of crimes with no other end in view but truth, justice, and fair play? But I think we have to look even deeper than that. Because by capturing the judiciary, the Marcos dictatorship held the entire legal profession hostage. He actually created a new breed of lawyers. I like to call them glorified fixers, who cultivated their closeness to the palace. These lawyers established networks among law enforcers, prosecutors, judges, and prison officials. The closer they were to the palace, the easier it was for them to set up these networks. Unfortunately, these networks outlasted that dictatorship, and they still operate today. Marcos was truly a brilliant lawyer. He knew that he needed control of the judiciary, the justice system, not only to remain in power, but to ensure that even after his regime ended, his family and cronies would escape punishment. And history shows that they did. Of course, after EDSA 1986, the Aquino government and succeeding governments tried to go after these lawyers, but their efforts actually failed. They were not able to dismantle these corrupt networks. They even tried to purge the judiciary, but somehow the judges removed, found their way back into the service in a few years. They tried to remove politics from the appointment of justice by establishing a judicial and bar council. But those same networks that arose during the Marcos dictatorship managed to infiltrate and influence that council. And while our 1987 constitution restored the independence of the judiciary, succeeding administrations neglected to weaken a justice system that had been tainted by the dictatorship. But martial law also gave rise to a courageous band of lawyers who took up the cause of human rights. Lawyers who realized that just as the law could be used to oppress, so could it also be used to liberate the people from oppression. Lawyers who saw that for the law to attain actual justice, it needed to be grounded on some form of humanity. But it was not an easy struggle. Just like today, drug users and pushers are branded as below human, human rights lawyers during the time of the dictatorship were also branded in the same way. They were called enemies of the state. They were harassed, threatened, arrested, detained, tortured, and even killed. And yet, despite all the odds and despite the prevalent fear, they fought and ultimately prevailed. And I'd like to tell this to all the young people I meet, if not for those few courageous lawyers and human rights advocates who stood up to that dark regime, if not for them, we would not be enjoying the rights and freedoms we have today. But now, these freedoms are again under attack, and human rights are being blamed as the cause of the problem. But are human rights really the cause of the problem of rampant crime and corruption? Or is it because we have such a weak legal system? In my personal view, the reason why crime and corruption are so rampant in the Philippines has nothing to do with human rights, but everything to do with our weak justice system. And if the problem is a weak justice system, then isn't the solution to strengthen it rather than to shortcut it? Instead of strengthening the justice system, however, the present dispensation has been waging a war on drugs that has supplanted justice from the courts with justice from the battles of guns. A war on drugs that has created a mutant police force that compiles names of alleged drug personalities instead of gathering evidence for prosecution and conviction. We may not realize it, but compiling names and reporting crimes is such a different thing. Citizens report crimes because they see or witness an incident, or they gain knowledge of an incident that happened and they know that the authorities should take action. But anyone can give a name for any reason. I may just have a grudge, personal or political, against another person, and I am free to put that name in a Dropbox or in somehow other supply that name to the police as a suspected drug personality. In the last 15 months, at least 3,850 people have been killed in police operations, allegedly because they resisted the police. Thousands more have been killed by death squads who roam our country with impunity, dispensing justice so so-called, from the barrels of their guns, deciding who are guilty and who are not, who deserves to live and who deserves to die, using fear and violence to enforce the law. The very same fear and violence that the Marcos dictatorship used so effectively 4 decades ago. The labels have changed, but the tactics are exactly the same. I quote from a lecture my father delivered in the early 1980s. Fear need not be of communists. It may be of terrorists, gangsters, or mere nonconformists. Whatever its cause, fear, carefully nurtured by the establishment, hardens the belief that communists, terrorists, dissenters, or if I may add, drug pushers and users, call them what you will, have forfeited their humanity, and so have forfeited their rights. Fear is a powerful motive, but an unreliable guide. It can create evils more monstrous than those it seeks to avoid. It can kill people, while kill freedom while trying to preserve it. If I may add, it can even kill the legal system while claiming to preserve it. And when that legal system suffocates and dies, as it did 45 years ago, the only form of government capable of maintaining order will have to be an authoritarian form of government. That is why I am deeply disturbed, not only by the government's war on drugs, but by its anti-human rights rhetoric. By supplanting justice from the courts with justice from the barrels of guns, by denigrating human rights, is the government setting the stage for a return to an authoritarian form of government? In conclusion, the rule of law and human rights, I believe we all agree, are vital in building accountable leadership. There really can be no genuine accountability without respect for the rule of law and human rights. Like it or not, the country appears to be moving in the direction of lesser accountability and more authoritarianism. There is still time, however, to stop the train and put it back on the right track. But the time to act is now.